This webinar is the fourth of our six-part lecture series on the topic of women's agency during Nazism, presented by the South African Holocaust and Genocide Foundation and the Austrian Embassy in Pretoria. Tonight, we will be focusing on the life and legacy of the anti-Nazi Austrian dancer, Hanna Berger. We will explore dance as a political art during the interwar period and World War II, as well as the passing on of its practices and memories today. Renowned dancer Eva-Maria Schaller will provide insight into her work on Hanna Berger. This will be accompanied by two addresses by Dr. Andrea Amort, professor at the Music and Arts University of the City of Vienna, and Rebecca Davis, the founder of MindLeaps, who will speak to us about dance and its utilization towards youth engagement and peace work. To begin, I'd like to provide a short introduction to our women of resistance tonight, Hanna Berger. Hanna Berger was born in Austria in August of 1910 and went on to become one of the most prolific representatives of modern dance in the 1930s and 40s. She studied dance in Berlin from 1929 to 1934 and became a proponent of what is known today as the free dance movement, a dance movement that was revolutionary and innovative for moving away from the traditional classical ballet style and instead focusing on personal feeling and expression through dance. Berger was a strong supporter of the Communist Party for many years from the age of 17. And as a critic of the Nazi regime, she was later forced to flee Germany in 1937 and return to Austria. According to Dr. Andrea Amort, one of our esteemed speakers tonight, Berger was one of the very few dance artists of the period who demonstrated a clear and political commitment to her works. Her solo choreographed works often included political elements, such as the brandishing of a red flag. Berger upheld a strong commitment to social justice in her work and maintained connections with the anti-Nazi resistance network in Berlin, known as the Red Orchestra. The Nazis annexed Austria in the Anschluss of 1938. And many Jewish artists, including Jewish dancers, were forced to flee. In 1939, the Nazis began shutting down what they deemed as radical modern dance establishments. In 1942, Hanna Berger was arrested by the Gestapo on charges of suspicion to commit high treason. Despite the lack of evidence, she was detained for several months. And then in August of 1943, Berger was sentenced to 2 years of forced labor in a concentration camp. But luckily, she managed to escape soon after during an Allied bombing of Berlin. She sustained some injuries, but fortunately evaded Nazi persecution for the rest of the war. Berger returned to Vienna in 1945 and dedicated the rest of her life to dance, working as a performer, critic, writer, and the director of a children's theater. She also taught dance as a professor at the University of Music and Performing Arts in Vienna. After her untimely death in 1962, at the age of 52 years old, Berger was buried in a grave of honor in Vienna. Her work has now been revived and passed down to a new generation of dancers. I would now like to introduce our guests for tonight. Our opening address is by Dr. Andrea Amort, an author, dramatist, curator, and dance historian, and a university professor and the scientific director of the Dance Archive at the Music and Arts University of the City of Vienna. Andrea has been credited with being part of the revival of Hanna Berger's work, bringing her legacy to the public through books, exhibitions, and dance performances around the world. Since 1998, Andrea has been the director of a series of events and lectures entitled Viennese Dance and Exile. Her most recent interdisciplinary project is called Hanna Berger, In the Footsteps of a Dissident Dancer. As Andrea is unfortunately unable to join us live tonight, she has sent us a short video address to share with you.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you, Aria, for the invitation to be part of this important series. Being the scientific and artistic head of the only 5 years old dance archive in Vienna, one of our major challenges is to research traces and collect material, including historical performative dance material, concerning mainly the Viennese Austrian modern dance scene starting from the late 19th century. As you may know, that the first decades of the modern dance scene in Vienna before 1938, the so-called Anschluss through the Nazis, were dominated by Jewish women, I started working on this topic during the late 90s. In 2000, I curated an exhibition on dance and exile in Vienna. Nearly 20 years later, another one big exhibition under the title The Cosmos of Viennese Dance Modernism, showing a whole artistic world before the racism of the Nazis. Included was also Hanna Berger, who died in 1962. One of the dancers and choreographers I'm working with is Eva-Maria Schaller. She has been researching the performative material of Hanna Berger and presented a whole program with the title Recalling Her Dance some days ago in Vienna. For her program, I wrote the following small text. The ground we dance on. For some time it has been clear to us, also in dancing. There is no tomorrow without yesterday, and only today we can make decisions on how to proceed. Considering the situation of the modern contemporary dance in Austria, pulsing deeply with a democratic attitude, the question of the where from and the where to always appears to be a precarious one. For one, the widely cited fleetingness of dance renders it impossible for the later born generation to create the chronology of work, aesthetics, and impact of their ancestors. We cannot reproduce the original. Secondly, we have to bear in mind that fascism's and National Socialism's destruction also violated all forms of dance. However, if we endeavor in seeking traces, in deepening our awareness for history and generations, we shall find a way. Critical contemporaneity may make it possible to reconnect with fragments of the dances that were handed on, to edit them anew and transfer them into a present. I've been spending time with the case of Hanna Berger, after the suggestion of my predecessors, not only because of the numerous testimonies of contemporary witnesses and their willingness to entrust me with material, but also due to Berger's persistence to struggle through life as a politically resistant artist. Coming from a working class family imprisoned during the NS dictatorship, marked with the blemish of a communist in the post-war years, Hanna Berger moved fiercely and loudly between Vienna, Italy, Paris, and Berlin. Now it's Eva Maria Schaller's turn who, as representative of a new generation, worked with Berger's texts and choreographic descriptions intensely. Even physically, she connects to the creative transfer and the culture of memory that were commenced in 1995 by Berger's former dancer Ottilie Mitterhuber and the young dancer Esther Koller with the solo L'Inconnu de la Seine. By accessing further works into her personal artistic view, Eva Maria Schaller is moving what I call the critical thinking and dancing in generations into a new intensive phase. So thank you for listening, and I think we switch over now to Eva Maria Schaller.
Thank you to Andrea. As Andrea noted, our next guest tonight is Eva Maria Schaller. Eva is a renowned dancer and performer based in Vienna. She performs Hanna Berger's choreography, which has been passed down to her through two generations of Berger's students. Eva has performed and toured in Europe, the United States, and Asia, and has taught the movement practice known as counter technique across Europe since 2016. In 2019, Eva was named one of the Emerging Artists of the Year by the Berlin Yearbook Tanz or Dance. Tonight, Eva will tell us about her artistic research on Hanna Berger and on the transmission of dance heritage to new generations. Over to you, Eva.
Hello, and thank you very much for the invitation. I'm quite honored to be part of this meeting and to talk about my most recent work that is based on Hanna Berger, on her dances and on her life. And yes, as was mentioned, I could show recently the work called Recalling Her Dance, a choreographic encounter with Hanna Berger at the Impulse Dance Festival in Vienna. And the piece had also a video premiere at Tanzquartier Vienna. And I would like to start by sharing with you how my involvement with the heritage of Hanna Berger, with her legacy, came about. And yes, so this starts basically in the 1950s. Hanna Berger passes on a solo of hers, the mentioned L'Inconnu de la Seine, in German, Die Unbekannte aus der Seine, over to a student of hers, Ottilie Mitterhuber, who then, several years later, teaches it to Esther Koller, another Viennese dancer, and from whom, in turn, I received this dance piece. Andrea Amort initiated this project. As she mentioned, 2 years ago, she made an exhibition in the theater museum called Cosmos of the Viennese Dance Modernism. And there was already dealing with how actually lively the dance scene was before and during the war, and also dealing with the emigration and the displacement of many, many, also mostly female artists that had to leave the scene. And in the frame of this exhibition, there were dances by these artists reconstructed and reworked. And there I had the honor to dance this solo. And I would like to give you a very short impression. And maybe, Aria, you can start the first video. Thank you. So this was a very short impression of the solo L'Inconnu de la Seine. And you might see that it is very aesthetic in a way and to the music of Claude Debussy. But actually, this is about a kind of a tragic moment in a woman's life. But I will come to that much later in the course of my presentation. So this this point was the starting point for me to occupy myself further with Hanna Berger, as I found the material very, very inspiring, also from a contemporary point of view. And also the working process was definitely something very, very special to work with Esther Koller and to work on this transmission of the dance material. And digging into who this woman was, I found that she had a fantastic approach to dance, to art, also to her time that she lived in, and a kind of an incredible biography. So yes, I was fascinated and hooked, and yes, so this is how the project began. And Andrea Amort was very helpful to actually feed me and to provide me with archive material, further archive material. And so in the course of this, actually now almost 3 years, I could develop this piece called Recalling Her Dance. And it is based on basically three dances by Hanna Berger, which are called Krieger, Warrior, Aufruf, which can be translated as Worker's Call, and the just mentioned L'Inconnu de la Seine. And since for each of these three dances, there were different archival material at hand, they all needed their own approach, their own research. And these three dances are kind of a red thread throughout my dramaturgy of the piece and depict distinctive events in the works and life of this extraordinary woman. And simultaneously, they mirror Hanna Berger's multifaceted and versatile being as a dancer and choreographer. And I would like now to go through these three dances in the order of the dramaturgy of the piece, and starting with Krieger, Warrior. And I will actually interweave a little bit again of her biography with my approach and research towards the dance. So as mentioned, in the course of my involvement, at some point I received a big pack of paper by Andrea Amort with the addition, "This is a task for you." And those were descriptions of works by Hanna Berger. So archival material and detailed descriptions on her dances, kind of dance entries and choreographic notes. And that was very exciting because this itself already points to her idea of passing on her work. And in this description, I found also a text on her dance Krieger. And this text was very appealing to me because it clearly describes the circumstances of her time in 1937 and how she experienced that time as a young woman. So actually we have to, it is just 1 year before the war breaks out. And at the same time, it is also a document of her working process, her rehearsals, and how she goes about the theme, how she develops this this piece. Now, my approach since writing was a big topic for Hanna Berger, I also wanted to take her text as a source material. Not music in that case, but really the text, and enter into it as a dialogue with my own physicality, with my own body. So this dance is not really what I would call a reconstruction, but more like a reimagination, because she describes so vividly, and it's very easy to empathize with her how she made her creation process. And as mentioned before,
So this piece was very critical. It has the title Warrior, but in that she criticized the image of the warrior. And it was certainly not the way how it was desired at that time, portraying the warrior figure not as a hero, but actually as a victim of his circumstances. And it also shows the devastation and the senselessness of war. So what I find exciting here is that she describes also how she explores the physical theme of falling, the falling warrior, dying warrior. And if we consider that it was the beginning of modern dance, it was still a new and very important element to deal with gravity, to also show something on stage with not going up and beauty and light, but something actually very powerful and very dark, and yes, to expose the body to the forces of gravity. So falling also becomes a metaphor for failure. And she describes, for example, a scene where she shows the piece a second time in a rehearsal situation, and she fails. And both in the political context and in her personal choreographic work, this is expressed. And that's very brave at that time, very ahead of her time, to let us look into her creative process. And that is what I found, yes, very remarkable of her. And maybe we can have a short look at the video clip again of the scene. Yes.
Mit der Frage in den Minen, warum ein Antlitz der Anklage? Vorführung der Arbeit vor einigen Kollegen übermannte mich die Empfindung so stark, dass ich sie erschüttert aussprach. Ich werde daran sterben. Die erste Kritik war eine anhaltende Erschütterung bei den Zuschauern. Das ist Kunst, hieß es, und großartig. In meiner zweiten Vorführung schlug der Pianist die Trommel, aber die Rhythmen waren noch nicht festgelegt. Im Gegensatz zur ersten Stellungnahme war die zweite vernichtet. Eine Woche wirkte ich an ihr. Ich war erschöpft.
When I showed the work a second time, in front of some colleagues, their reaction was quite the opposite of the enthusiastic first one. It was a disaster. The pianist was beating the drums, but the rhythms were not fixed yet. And so that did not work at all. And I tried to make up for the absolute failure of the musical accompaniment by exaggerating my emotions and overacting all my movements so hard that I literally fell on my face and hurt my nose.
Thanks. So, as you could see, there is also some free space, also with the layers of text. I found it very interesting
to translate also her text, because it loses all historicism, and it can be very very now. It can be experienced now, like it was. It was not very far away from what I think every creative artist knows in the process of creation. So after Krieger, after Warrior, let's continue with a part of her biography, and I will just point out some details. So after this performance in 1937, this is the reason why she has to flee. She already has some problems with the Nazi regime there, and she has to leave from Berlin. She can flee to Vienna. After the so-called Anschluss of Austria to Nazi Germany in 1938, she spends a lot of time in Italy together with her partner, the Austrian sculptor Fritz Kremer. And from 1940, she lives again in Berlin, where she becomes involved in the resistance together with Fritz Kremer, as mentioned before, in the Schulze Boysen group. In the years before, she had already repeatedly criticized fascism under a pseudonym in a Swiss newspaper, and she even criticized her dancer colleagues who were collaborating with the Nazis. And I would like to just quote one sentence of hers. "The truth is always unpleasant to National Socialism, whether it is expressed in a work of art or in discussions at stamp sites." In the fall of 1942, Berger is arrested for facilitating anti-state communist meetings in her apartment and suspicion of preparation for high treason. She spends 10 months in custody and ultimately was acquitted due to lack of evidence and also the intervention of prominent advocates. Nevertheless, she had to serve like a 2-year camp sentence, but is able to flee during a bombing attack. And back in Austria, she dances the piece Aufruf, which is sometimes also called Kampfruf, and apparently was created during her imprisonment. It was shown in Vienna, especially in 1945 and 1946. And there are some impressive photos where she dances it in front of former prisoners of concentration camps. I will just show a short picture. So, yes. Okay. I see that I have to kind of speed up a little bit my talk. So, I will continue. So, what is special about this work? Actually, the clearest thing I could find in a notebook of one of her students, and it was written, "The whole thing is a worker's call to his comrades to break out of their routine and follow him. Heavy worker's hands, strong legs that never tire, determined face whose bitterness is outshone by the idealistic spirit of struggle." And there is also a very short film fragment of Aufruf where you could see Berger dancing. So that was, in that case, my main source of material. And that was, of course, very impressive to learn from there with the help of her choreographic notes, actually. And I would like to read you a short personal comment that I wrote last year in relation to studying this piece. It is entitled "A Crossing Between Time and Space," April 2020. During the preparations and research for this piece, I intensively studied and trained a section of Hanna Berger's dance Aufruf. In other words, it became a choreographic practice, dealing with specific bodily dynamics and the expression that was to be conveyed in the dance, to be manifested in the movements, in a certain gestural vocabulary, evoked a completely and unpredictably strong sentiment of solidarity within me, a feeling of great intensity that I would describe as such. Now I perceive the people in the public transport as a community, as a we. We who we all do our things. We who we all pursue our businesses and professions. And I didn't feel like such a disconnected individual anymore. I rather felt that my doing was also connected with all the other people and all the other activities. So where does this shift, this change in perception come from? From the rehearsals, from practicing, training, and repeating these gestures? Did the thoughts and feelings that are inherent in the gestures of Hanna Berger's original choreography find their way through my body into my conscience? And yes, so I think these thoughts and questions lead quite directly, let's say, to the last and most core and essential part of this whole project and of the dance piece, and to the solo Die Unbekannte aus der Seine, L'Inconnue de la Seine. As I mentioned at the very beginning, the L'Inconnue de la Seine was made in 1942 and was passed on to me by Esther Koller, who danced it a generation before me, and she learned it in a process of remembering together with the Berger student Ottilie Mitterhuber. The special thing about it is that it is passed on from hand to hand, one could say very directly from dancer to dancer in the studio. So there is a personal artistic process, a direct exchange between the dancers. The approach to the movement is shared, the approach to art, and that is a very powerful thing in itself. Of course, each dancer has her own interpretation, but the essence, I would say, remains there. And I was not really familiar with the subject of L'Inconnu de la Seine. It is actually about an art icon, about a death mask of a beautiful woman who was found in the River Seine in Paris, and it's kind of a poetic myth that inspired a lot of artists. And so kind of a heavy theme, but then I was surprised how fluid, how flowing, and I think this was also owned to Esther Koller, as she said, like, this is also about transformation. And yes, so it was very easy to have a space also for a contemporary approach. And it didn't feel historical at all. I guess this is why it was also possible and in a way very organic to, together with the composer Matthias Kranebitter, recreate even a first part of this solo in terms of movement and in terms of music. And this, we made it in a way that they flow towards or they culminate in the original piece that was passed on to me. And yes, there were only a few pictures and a very short scene description, and I would like to share them with you. The wandering on the shore, the luring of the water, hesitation, a fear of continuing to live greater than of death, the decision, going into the water, being carried by the waves, and the freezing. And Aria, can you still show maybe one the video part that I sent you?
Thank you. Aria. Yes.
This was the piece Aufruf. I wanted to still share from the very end of the video, Aria, maybe you can share one of the parts towards the minute 40 or 37. Yes, and this, I don't know if it is still possible to show the next clip, because this kind of would really close to the very beginning of the, this would close my thing and then I think I'm done, but it shows the whole cycle, how it goes back to the original piece. Okay.
Thank you. I think I will close my talking here. I ran a bit out of time, but I think there is still a question and answer. And yes, it was an impression on these three dances and how I worked with it and put them into a, merge them into a kind of contemporary approach. Yes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Eva, for sharing your moving work with us and for bringing the spirit of Hanna Berger to life. There will be time for questions at the end of our webinar, so please feel free to enter your questions to Eva or to our next speaker, Rebecca, into the chat or the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. I would now like to introduce our final guest for tonight, Rebecca Davis. Rebecca is the founding director of MindLeaps, an organization that runs dance and education programs for the underserved youth in developing countries. Rebecca holds a master's in international relations with a focus in peacekeeping from the American Military University and a postgraduate certificate in ballet and choreography studies. She has also run her own professional dance company. In this presentation, Rebecca will be looking at dance and its utilization as a tool for youth and civic engagement in Africa. Thank you very much, Rebecca.
Thank you too, and thank you everybody for having the chance to share these stories of peace and resistance with you tonight. Eva, what a beautiful and important presentation and performance as well. Okay, everyone. Thank you so much for taking the time to think through the power of dance. I think if we were wanted to understand or examine a little bit why dance is so powerful as a tool for peace and resistance, we could come up with a lot of words, but I think three of my words would be safety, unity, and freedom. And I'd like to share with you some stories from post-genocide environments where we've seen those qualities change the way that peace can be built after conflict. So this picture that you see here was taken in July last month in Rwanda, in Kigali, Rwanda. Some of you probably recognize it from this audience, from this community. This is the amphitheater that's been built in Gisozi, right next to the Memorial Museum, marking the 1994 genocide against the Tutsi. And in the last 6 years, Rwanda has decided to mark the end of the 100-day period of the genocide with an arts festival. Of all of the things that we could do to mark this important occasion, we are choosing to celebrate it with the arts. This is a photo of children who are dancing to mark the end of that 100-day period of mourning last month. And if I was to tell you more about these kids, you would start to see how resistance and peace builds through movement. These are children whose lives were completely interrupted, not because they were alive during the genocide, but because their parents are survivors. And in most cases, these are single mothers who don't have the full capacity to raise their children to become what they might have been if there hadn't been this war. So these children were out of school, struggling to survive, and they came into a program which is called MindLeaps for the only reason that they love to dance. And through this dance program, now what are they doing with their skill, with their passion, with their talent, with their stable lives? They are using dance to communicate to the next generation the power of Rwanda. These are a mixture of countries where MindLeaps runs this program. And I could pick like any red spot on this map and tell you stories of peace and resistance through dance. The story of Gloria stems from the story we just looked at with this arts festival in Rwanda. Gloria was being raised by her mother, who was HIV positive because she was raped during the genocide in Rwanda. And she died, and this became a child-headed household with her older brother trying to raise her. That was very difficult, very stressful, and Gloria started to slip into prostitution. What is it that changed the trajectory of Gloria's life? It wasn't somebody saying, go to school. It wasn't somebody saying, here's food for today. Actually, it was Gloria joining a dance program. And you're going to think, like, how on earth could that save this girl's life? But it comes back to those things that we talked about. Safety. For the first time in her life, when she came into this space and saw other kids dancing and other kids supporting her and people telling her she's a worthwhile human being, she started to feel safe. One of the biggest things we can do to decrease the likelihood of war and conflict is to feel safe and not feel that we have this fear. And then from that safety, she started to find a community. The home was not the community she was going to find, but she found a new place where she had a family and she had unity. Personally, I don't think Gloria's at that point of freedom yet, But hopefully this journey, supported through dance and supported through the arts, is bringing her to that final place. If I was to flip the map and choose a different example, I would choose this example from North Macedonia. North Macedonia is not a post-genocide country, but what marks North Macedonia and why it's famous in these international relations circles is because of this deep, deep division between Macedonians and Albanians. And this division is grown and grown in the next generation of youth, to the point where people like kind of scratch their heads and they don't know what to do anymore to try to bring these people together, especially when you see it at the level of the youth. Well, guess what? When you bring in the tool of dance, which doesn't require Albanian language or Macedonian language, it's not associated with one of the religions of each group. All of a sudden you have like this equalizer in play. So Aikuna, this girl up here in the splits and this girl down here with the gigantic smile, she is an Albanian dancer who teaches kids who are Macedonian in Skopje, the capital city of North Macedonia. And she herself is 22 years old and she's a cancer survivor. When you ask her, like, how, Aikuna, are you the person you are today at 22 years old? She'll tell you one very simple story. She'll tell you when she was going through chemo, what she would do every day that she could is she would go and she would sit in the dance studio and she would just sit there because she didn't have the strength to do anything. But when she sat there, she felt like she was part of a group. She felt unity and she felt safety. Now, these years after her recovery, she has the freedom to do whatever she wants in the world. And what she's choosing to do is teach dance to help the next generation. I'd like to share with you a very short video, and I know we're short on time, so we might just watch the first half. And this video is from yet another one of these red squares on our map, which is from Mauritania, West Africa. So Mauritania was the last country in the world to end slavery. And that happened in 1981. So the youth that we work with in Mauritania today, their parents were either masters or slaves. And it's a multi-ethnic society with four different ethnic groups, all of which speak different languages. And what is the thing that's bonding this community together? Once again, we come back to dance. Let me share with you just a short insight into one of our female dancers there.
Salut, je m'appelle Hanna Berger. J'ai 23 ans. J'ai né à Elmina et j'ai grandi à Elmina. J'ai grandi avec mes parents et mes grandes sœurs et frères. J'ai étudié à Elmina. J'ai laissé à l'école à 4e collège. Au début de mon inscription ici au MindLeaps, car je n'avais pas beaucoup d'amis, je ne sais pas c'est quoi amical déjà. Je bagarre beaucoup avec des gens, je ne sais pas c'est quoi, des trucs passent. Mais avec le temps, MindLeaps m'a changé, m'a fait savoir beaucoup de choses, m'a fait savoir c'est quoi l'amical, comment on prend un ami. Et comment on parle avec des gens, car tout cela je ne savais pas. Et j'ai trouvé ici beaucoup de mes amis. Maintenant, je suis une formatrice de danse à MindLeaps et SOS. Et je me suis toujours développé les compétences des élèves, à aider à retourner à l'école. Et ça aussi, c'est une fierté pour moi et pour mon communauté. Et l'impact que MindLeaps m'a fait sur moi, et je suis là, je suis une responsabilité de moi-même et une responsabilité de ma famille. MindLeaps a impacté ma communauté, les enfants, beaucoup d'enfants qui n'avaient pas que des moyens. Maintenant, MindLeaps a leur donné des chances à changer, à retourner à l'école. Mon intérêt sur danse, c'est je me sens free avec danse. cause de cela, j'aime bien être formatrice pour changer des autres enfants comme moi et rêver beaucoup de choses que je n'ai jamais rêvées. Les jours que j'aime, c'est lundi. Oui, parce que lundi, je monte à SOS.
So as you can see, just through these images, again, this community is being built for these very simple reasons that movement is this unifying force. So this kind of begs the question then. So, okay, we're saying all of these things, dance, right? They help us, they're generating, you know, these ideas of unity and freedom. But is there a deeper level to understand why this is the way it is? So MindLeaps wanted to try to dig deeper into the understanding of the methodology. And I was asked to speak a little bit on like the theory of dance connecting these issues. And we came up with a way to measure social emotional learning and cognitive development through movement patterns. And we were very fortunate to work with Drexel University and Carnegie Mellon University and engineers from the private sector to actually build a tool that allows you to analyze when particular movements are done, how does that connect to one of these skills? So for example, if we gave you a movement sequence of 8 different things, would you be able to recall that sequence after 1 showing, after 2 showings, after 3 prompts? And all the way up to some of the skills that we're talking about today, like teamwork, which we might substitute for unity, and creativity and self-esteem that you saw so beautifully in Eva's presentation. So imagine, which is not so hard to imagine because it exists, but imagine that you can actually see the power of building these skills through movement and dance, so that we can now start to talk about something on a research level, on a scientific level, on a quantitative level, that we inherently know as human beings, and that we inherently know from looking at the history of these post-genocide movements, we know it's possible, but we can also measure it. So I think what I would love to try to inspire or leave you with here today is recognizing that you may not be a dancer, but you are someone who cares about peace and building peace around the world. And if we can learn from all of the stories of our history that tie these particular dances, these particular heroes, these particular movements, these particular systems to peace and celebrate these stories of change, we can join together to help to build the tools that we have available to fight genocide, to build peace, and to celebrate reconciliation. So I would go on and on and on, but I'll pause here and say thank you so much for allowing me the space to share some of these stories today.
Thank you very much, Rebecca, for sharing your amazingly uplifting and inspiring work with us. Rebecca is tuning in at the moment from Ghana, so really we thank you for being with us and to all of our speakers tonight. Before we close, we'd like to spend a few minutes for any questions from the audience. So if you have any questions, please feel free to write them in the chat or in the Q&A box below. To start, ladies, I'd like to ask you both how you got into the work that you are presently doing. So for Eva, how did you come across the work of Hanna Berger? How did you begin to work with her material and why has it become something that you've become so immersed in? And Rebecca as well, how did you in your world begin doing this amazing work that you're doing? So should we start with Eva?
Yes. Yeah, thank you for this question. So I already mentioned that like it kind of the work of Hanna Berger somehow, I have to say that it really came to me, and I also perceive that it is a big gift that was that came to me because Andrea Amort initiated the process of that Esther Koller, this dancer who danced the piece, the solo piece before me, would pass it on. So it, the initiation point was really this meeting with the other dancer who had learned this heritage piece and the working process with this dancer. And that was, I'm very happy to hear what you have just spoke about, Rebecca, also, because that was actually a part that I now had to leave out because of time, that Hanna Berger was a very passionate teacher also. And she, after the war, she dedicated a lot to education of younger dancers. And I think that somehow this spirit of being that open also with her dance material is somehow also in immanent in her material. Like I did also some other dance historical and reconstruction work where it is not in that way. And I think that this is why I became so passionate about it, that I felt it is very open and it has this uplifting spirit. And also talking to her student, Ottilie Mitterhuber, who is now a 90-year-old woman, I wanted to know all, of course, about Hanna Berger and how she experienced Hanna Berger. And talking with her about dance, she described a little bit the dances, but the main thing she gave to me was really like, now you are doing that dance, and just the way you do it, it will be yours, and this is what you give to the world. And I think that's very powerful, and I think that is also definitely what she got from Hanna Berger. I really believe that this spirit of the passion also of passing on and multiplying your love for dancing or whatever it is, that's so important also in it. And yes, another thing, but I will then close my answer, is that I find it also for me a gift because we have this really difficult history that kind of is some generations away from us. So it is not that drastic as the places that you are working, for example, in Rebecca, but you always wonder about this history, about this really problematic history, and to enter it through a woman that I can really admire and take inspiration from, it is one way to look at also this history and to really literally, that's why I read this text before, like, to understand something physically is really to empathize and to really know something also in its complexity, and also to be able to take this complexity. And I think when it comes to conflict or war and such, the physical digestion of it, it really opens other dimensions to dealing with these things. And yeah, I think that's my answer.
Thank you. Happy to follow on. For me, it was a very specific life event. I was running my dance company, as you mentioned in the introduction, and we were creating dance works around social justice issues, and we chose to do a dance production around the genocide in Darfur. And the experience of researching that piece, we used the book, The Devil Came on Horseback, and translated that into a ballet, was so monumental for me and the other artists I was working with that it created inside us like a deep thirst for knowledge to try to understand what happens in a post-genocide environment. And that's what took me to Rwanda on like a personal journey to try to find answers to that question. And then being on the ground in Rwanda and then subsequently Bosnia-Herzegovina and many of these other countries, I recognize that that power, the power of the tool of dance, can be used directly in these communities. It doesn't just need to be used as a tool to raise awareness on the outside. And that's what kind of transitioned me into the field work that MindLeaps does today.
Wonderful, thank you. I see in the chat, we have a few questions. Please feel free to continue to add. Rebecca, for you, I see you did write in the chat, but maybe you could share with everybody. Tali Nates, who's the director of our Johannesburg Holocaust and Genocide Center, wrote amazing and inspiring work. Thank you. Did you ever work with survivors of genocide? And how was that process regarding memorialization and healing work with some of those survivors? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Great question. So our direct work is really with the children who are the children of the survivors of these genocides. And that's the case in Rwanda. It's the case in Bosnia and Herzegovina. In the refugee camps where we're working in Rwanda and the refugee settlements in Uganda, the youth that we've trained to now run these dance programs on a regular basis are the survivors of mass atrocities, particularly in Burundi and DRC, Sudan and South Sudan. And so kind of we have connecting points to all of these different groups. Where I would say that the healing and the memorialization that you see with the direct survivors of genocide is almost like it's removed from an ability to connect it to the person in our experience. It really is very difficult to have that person kind of unpeel the entire wrapping to get to the core and then connect those movements directly to their healing process. Those that are slightly removed from it or who have other memories that have been created between the genocide and their lives now seem to then be more open to reflecting and tackling those issues in healing and memorialization and speaking about it openly through movement and verbally. It seems to be a more fluid process for them. That being said, if you think that each case is specific and somewhat more nuanced than how I make it sound, I think also, you know, it sounds crazy to say something like this for countries in West Africa, but if you take a country like Guinea-Conakry, I mean, a lot of people think that that's a pre-genocide environment when you look at the ethnic tension across the country. And I think understanding kind of also how dance sits as a preemptive tool to genocide is something that needs to be recognized and researched more in the field.
Thank you so much. Thank you also to Daryl, who wrote in our chat about the work that he's doing. He said he works with children born in captivity in northern Uganda, and he also uses dance as a tool to empower them, articulate their issues, and to fight against the stigma and marginalization that they experience. So thank you very much for that work that you do. I have two more questions and then we'll wrap up for the evening. This is for Eva. Heather Blumenthal, who's the director of the Cape Town Holocaust and Genocide Center, writes, when I watch you dance, one is able to see the many layers of the story. How does this form of dance and history resonate with young people in Austria or specifically Vienna? And Nancy Krisch, also to Eva, as a German Jewish woman whose family was from Berlin, I am inspired and incredibly moved by your presentation. So thank you very much. And she wrote that in German. Eva, how are people inspired in Austria and Vienna by your work?
That is very great that we recently showed the work at Impulse Tanz, and it's actually not so easy to describe. So of course there was a live public also that was a bit special because, as we know, we have been kind of kept not being able to play in a theater. So that was like a double strong impression also on me. Like also even during the performing the piece, I could, for me, it already is like second nature. You know, I was so busy with this material for 3 years, and already while performing, I could sense that the audience is really so, they were so silent and so concentrated. And I was reminded that wow, okay, they are really, really curious also. And I had really some people approached me also after the performance, of course, on many different layers. Like some people are really interested in, yes, how the transmission really works. And then they are curious about the, like actually questions like, why does it look so contemporary and not old at all? And so one on the kind of the more the dance level. And the other thing is that then I was also talking to some younger people, also colleagues, also friends, but also people I didn't know that well. And I noticed that it really stimulates a lot of questions. And I'm luckily able to answer a lot of questions about the work. And by that, going quite detailed into what I know about the history of Hanna Berger, and by that opening up again more details and perspectives of that time again. So it's really like a door and a door and a door. This is how I think that it does. Like, it makes people curious. I think this is how I would describe it. And It's also actually not, I know you asked about young people, but I also had some reactions from a bit older people, and that was also very, very touching. Like, they shared some personal stories, which I felt, it's good that like I said, it opens, people are able to suddenly talk about certain things, and this is still so alive. And this is what I felt also mostly, like, it connects, you start to open up new connections in your, in your perception of that issue, of that whole big issue. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I noticed a beautiful message in the chat from Barbara. And I think it's just a really great way to end this webinar, which has been so meaningful. So thank you to all of our speakers. Barbara, I hope you don't mind if I read this out. She is thanking us for the opportunity, for the insights into the aspects of the power of dance. And Barbara says, my sincere thanks to the wonderful women who participated, each in her own way. You have inspired me with your commitment to the broadness offered by dance for promoting human rights, peace, and history, through insight to a heroine of the Nazi period, and most importantly, for all your work that you are doing today. I wish you strength and energy to continue your work. Thank you, Barbara, so much for that message, and we echo that absolutely. To end off, on behalf of my colleagues at the South African Holocaust and Genocide Foundation, as well as the Austrian Embassy in Pretoria, we thank everyone for joining us today for this webinar. We will have a recording of it on our YouTube channel shortly. And we hope to see you again at our next lecture in this series, number 5 of the series of 6. It will be entitled Post-Holocaust and Apartheid Memories Confronting Traumatic Pasts. It will take place exactly 1 week's time on Tuesday, the 24th of August, 7 p.m. South African time. Aria has posted the details in the chat for you. And thank you again to all of our wonderful speakers for joining us from around the world. And for joining, and for all the audience for joining us as well. We wish you a good night.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. You.